Students, yesterday we have seen basic concepts and definition of a measurement system. Students, is my voice audible?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Sir, audible, sir.
So yesterday we have seen basic introductory topics and we have seen definition of measurement system, and this is block diagram of a measurement system or controlling a parameter in a plan. Okay, so here we can say this as a measurement system or control system. This is a chamber or plan. In this we have to control or measure one physical parameter. Physical parameter means temperature, flow, level of a liquid, flow rate of a liquid. Okay, so like that we have to measure one parameter in this closed chamber or plan. And we have arranged a sensor. We have arranged a sensor to detect the variations in this parameter, physical parameter. We have arranged a sensor. We have arranged a sensor. This sensor will detect variations in physical parameter. The sensor has direct contact with the physical parameter. Okay. Next, sensor will give some output, and that is given to the signal conditioning block. Sensor will give some output and it will give that output to the signal conditioning block. Sensor cannot give either voltage or current as output in most of the cases. Sensor cannot give a voltage or current as output in most of the cases. So it can give some resistance variation or capacitance variation or some displacement variation like that. So that output is given to the signal conditioning block. What is signal conditioning? Sensor output is not suitable for the process. What is the meaning of process? We have to analyze data. During that analysis, we will come to know the variations in the physical parameter. The variations in the physical parameter. We have to analyze sensor output to estimate the physical parameter variations. But that data is not suitable for the process. We have to make that signal as suitable for the further process. To make that signal for the further process. For the further process, we use signal conditioning block. Next, the signal conditioning will manipulate that data which is obtained from the sensor, and it will give to the data transmission block. Data transmission block will receive data from the signal conditioning block, and it will supply same data to the various blocks. Here you can see it is going to the display, and it is coming to the alarm block, and it is coming to the controller block, and sometimes we may have printer. Here printer block is not shown, but we may have printer block. So like the data transmission block work is to transmit same data to the various blocks. So display block will display the obtained data from the data transmission block, and alarms will make horns if there is a dangerous situations in the plant, and data will come to the controller, and this is our computer. This is our computer. Computer can be a microprocessor or microcontroller or our desktop computer. So here, this controller will analyze the data which is obtained from the sensor. Sensor has direct contact with the physical parameter. It has some output. Output is not suitable for the next process. So we will manipulate by using signal conditioning. Signal conditioning will give a data which is suitable for the further process, and it will give that data to the data transmission. And data transmission block will give that information to the controller. Here, controller will again analyze that received data, and it will estimate whether that physical parameter is at the required state, or if it is beyond the rate, or if it is less than the required state. If it is beyond the required state, it has to take a decision to decrease the physical parameter value within the plant. Or if the physical parameter value is less than the required state, it has to increase that physical parameter within the plant. So depending on the required value and obtained value, it will take a decision to increase or decrease the physical parameter, and it will pass on the orders to the actuator. Actuator is a device which can switch on, switch off that physical parameter within the plant. And again, here you can see signal conditioning block, because computer will give only digital data. In some cases, digital data is not suitable to switch on the analog devices. Analog devices require only voltage or current to switch on, switch off devices. But here, computer will give data which is equal to zeros and ones. That data may not be suitable to switch on the actuator. So we need signal conditioning. Signal conditioning, some cases it can be digital to analog converter, D2A converter. Signal conditioning here, it can be a data digital to analog converter. And here we can see order transmission. Students, near the computer, we have other block, that is supervisor. Supervisor is nothing but a human being. And students, here you can see orders transmission is displaying orders on the monitors or digital display devices. Whatever decision taken by the computer or whatever decision taken by the supervisor, they are giving to the order transmission block, and the order transmission block is giving data to the display, and it is allowing the data to the signal conditioning block. And here, supervisor, a human being, can take decisions than the computer, or he can overrule this computer. He can switch off this computer in rare cases, and he can run this entire plant. Why we are placing computer here? To minimize the human interference in controlling the plant. But in hazardous situations, humans can take control on the computer, and they can make them switch off, and they can control this entire plant. So here, this block diagram shows measurement system or controlling system of a physical parameter. And here we have information like any of these functions can be local or remote, but remote functions require information transmission. So supervisor can stay at home, and he can control this entire plant using data transmission or using wireless internet, Modern measurement systems are not physically arranged according to data flow in figure, but are instead arranged according to their connection to the digital bus communicating different subsystems. Students, this is just a representation of a basic plan, and there is no rule to have only this type of architecture in controlling a plant. Depending on the situations, they will design their plant. depending on the application, they can design their own plants. But basic structure of a plant will be like this. Basic structure of the plant will be like this. So let's go through these points for 2 minutes. Next, I'll go to the next slide. Next topic, students, transducers, sensors, and actuators. Transducers, sensors, and actuators. Students, here you can see a sensor. In some cases, we can use transducer here. And here we are using actuator. We will see what is actuator and sensor transducer. A transducer is a device that converts a signal from one physical form of two corresponding signal having a different physical form. Therefore, it is an energy converter. A transducer is a device that converts a signal from one physical form to a corresponding signal having a different physical form. Therefore, it is an energy converter. Students, if you take a solar cell, it will convert light energy to voltage. If you take a solar cell, it will receive light energy and it will convert that light energy to voltage. Voltage is one form of energy and light is another form of energy. So, solar cell is converting one form of energy to other form of energy. So it can be called as a transducer. So that is the definition of transducer. It has to receive one form of energy and it has to convert it into other form of energy. But whereas yesterday we have seen RTD is sensing temperature, it is varying its own resistance. That resistance will not be an energy, it is an other physical parameter or electronic parameter. It is changing its own physical property. So RTD is a sensor. Yesterday in lab session we have seen RTD is a sensor, but solar cell can be a transducer. There are 6 different kinds of signals: mechanical signal, thermal signal, magnetic, electric. Yes, motor can be a transducer because it receives voltage and it is converting into mechanical energy. So motor can be a transducer. Generator can be a transducer. Generator will receive mechanical energy and it will convert it into voltage. So generator can be a transducer. Very good, sir. So here we have 6 form of energies: mechanical, thermal, magnetic, electric, chemical and radiation. In radiation again we have subdivisions, so I am not going into that subdivisions. So these are the fundamental energy forms. So any device is receiving one form of energy and it is converting into other form of energy, that can be called as transducer. Any device receives one form of physical energy and it is, if it is converting into other form of energy, it can be called as a transducer. Students, give some examples for transducers.
Thermometer, antenna.
Loudspeaker, sir.
Very good. Thermometer is a sensor. Okay, thermometer is a sensor because it will expand. That expansion or that the changes in that physical dimensions we will measure. Okay, and we can call that antenna as a transducer. And you said loudspeaker. Loudspeaker is also a transducer. Very good.
Microphone, sir.
Yes, pardon?
Microphone.
Vibrator.
Microphone.
Microphone. Yes, microphone can be a transducer.
Electric motor, sir.
Yes, electric motor can be a transducer. Some students are giving answers in chat box. Let me see. Yes, servo motor, microphones, water heater converts electrical energy into thermal energy. Very good, students. It can be a transducer. Pressure sensor. Pressure sensor is a sensor. If you define its name, I can say whether it is sensor or transducer. But you have written as pressure sensor. Okay, fine. Water heater is a transducer, students. Very good. Many answers I got. So this is about transducer, students. The resulting signals can be of any useful physical form. The resulting signals can be of any useful physical form. Devices offering an electric outputs are called sensors. Devices offering an electric output. Students, here Electric output should not be voltage or current because those two are different form of energies, electric and electrical energies. If the device is giving us either resistance variation or capacitance variation or inductance variation, these three comes under electrical passive outputs. If device is giving that, it can be called as sensor. Measurement systems use electric signals and hence relay and sensors. Most measurement systems use electric signals and hence relay and sensors. So in previous figure, so here entire process depending on sensor output. If sensor is accurate, this entire system will work accurately. All devices are depending on sensor output. Most measurement systems use electric signals and hence rely on sensors. Electronic measurement systems provide the following advantages. Sensors can be designed for any non-electric quantity by selecting an appropriate material. Any variation in non-electric parameter implies a variation in an electric parameter because of the electronic structure of matter. So yesterday we have studied RTD, right? RTD purpose is to estimate temperature. Temperature is not electrical parameter. It is a physical parameter. But RTD depending on resistance variation. So if you place RTD near the temperature at high temperatures, RTD will change its own resistance because RTD structure is like that. It can vary its own resistance. So non-electric quantity, non-electric temperature, and we are using electrical parameter to estimate that temperature. Energy does not need to be drained. Energy does not need to be drained from the process being measured because sensor output signals can be amplified. Sometimes students, sensor output will be very, very less. So at that times we use amplifiers. Amplifier is an electronic circuit which can take a low voltage and which can produce high voltage. Sometimes sensor output will be millivolts, in millivolts. If we give that millivolts to an amplifier, we can convert it into volts. So 10 times, 100 times, 1000 times. We can increase that output. There is a variety of electronic amplifiers yield low power gains exceeding 10 to the power of 10 in a single stage. The energy of the amplifier output comes from its power supply. The amplifier input signal only controls that energy. So amplifier can increase input to the 100 times. Okay. So not only 100 times, 10 to the power of 10 we can increase. There is a variety of integrated circuits available for electric signal conditioning or modification. Some sensors integrate these conditioners in a single package. So here I have represented sensor in a different block, signal conditioning in a different block. Nowadays these two can be designed on a single device. These two can be designed as single device. Sensor and signal conditioning will be available in a one part. That's one block. One block. So that is very useful for us. No need to connect manually sensor and signal conditioning blocks. Many options exist for information display or recording by electronic means. These permits us to handle numerical data and text graphics and diagrams. So students, here display I have written. This display can be a monitor or a TV or a LCD projector, or sometimes just a digital display which can display only numbers. Like in our elevators, that display can display only numbers. So that type of display systems we can use. If you take ECG measurement, ECG can be printed on a paper. So in that case, the paper will be our display system. While you are measuring ECG in hospitals, they will draw that ECG graph on a paper. Sometimes they will see on monitor, and most of the cases they will make a printout. If there is no monitor to display ECG, if you have only paper to print that ECG, that paper can be our display system in that case. Okay. So signal transmission is more versatile for electrical signals. Mechanical, hydraulic or pneumatic signals may be appropriate in some circumstances, such as environments where ionizing radiation or explosive atmospheres are present, but electric signals prevail. So the last point belongs for the data transmission, and we have number of ways to transmit data. Nowadays everything will be wireless. If we have internet, we can transmit data through internet without using wires. And if you want to transmit mechanical or hydraulic pneumatic signals, we can transmit by using appropriate devices. So this is about transducers and sensor, students. In coming slides, we will see actuators also. I will give you 2 minutes time. You just go through this slide. Next, I will go to the next slide. Sensor and transducer are sometimes used as synonym terms. Transducer implies that input and output quantities are not the same. Sensor may not be a transducer. So if you take solar cell students, if we have more light energy, we will get more voltage. So to estimate the light energy, we can use voltage. If you measure voltage, depending on that voltage quantity or voltage value, we can estimate the light energy. So in that case, solar cell is acting as a sensor to sense the light energy. So transducer can be a sensor, but sensor cannot be a transducer because it cannot convert one form of energy to other. The word modifier has been proposed for instances where input and output quantities are the same, but it has not been widely accepted. So sometimes in some textbooks, they refer sensor as transducer, but that is not correct. The distinction between input transducer and output transducer is seldom used at present. Input transducers are termed as sensors or detectors for radiation, and output transducers are termed as actuators or effectors. Students, if you understand actuators, we can understand this sentence. But here what you have to understand is, sometimes transducers can be acted as sensors, and sometimes transducers can be acted as actuators. So depending on the application, depending on the situation, transducers can be a sensor or actuators. Sensors are intended to acquire information. Actuators are designed mainly for power conversion. When measuring mechanical quantities, a primary sensor converts the measurement into a measuring signal. When measuring mechanical quantities, when we are measuring mechanical quantities, a primary sensor converts the measurement into measuring signal. Mechanical quantities means, if you want to estimate displacement of a device, or if you want to estimate speed of a vehicle, or if you want to calculate dimensions of a device, in such case, if you want to use a sensor, there we can use that sensor can convert that physical dimension or mechanical quantity into electrical signal. Then a sensor would convert the signal into an electronic signal. For example, a diaphragm is a primary sensor that stresses when the subjected to a pressure difference, and a strain gauge sense that stress. Then a sensor would convert that signal into an electric signal. For example, a diaphragm is a primary sensor that stresses when subjected to a pressure difference, and strain gauge sense that stress. Students, here you have two new terms. First one is diaphragm, second one is strain gauge. Students, diaphragm is a device like our mobile phone, like computer, like a car. In the same way, diaphragm is a device. Okay, the purpose of diaphragm is, it has to estimate force applied on it or pressure applied on it. How to define pressure? Force per unit area is called as pressure. So if you apply pressure on a diaphragm, it will expand like balloon. Okay, so like elastic material, if you apply pressure on it, it will expand. And the second new term is strain gauge. Strain gauge is also another device. So if we connect this diaphragm and strain gauge, on diaphragm, if you are applying pressure, it will expand. And when it is expanding, it will create stress on strain gauge. So strain gauge is a device which can estimate stress or strain. Strain gauge is a device which can estimate stress or strain. So you are applying force on diaphragm, it is expanding and it is connected to the strain gauge. So strain gauge will estimate changes in diaphragm. When strain gauge is estimating changes in diaphragm, that directly proportional to the applied force on the diaphragm. So we are measuring force by using two devices, diaphragm and strain gauge. Here what you have to understand is diaphragm is a separate device, strain gauge is a separate device. Diaphragm property, if you apply force on diaphragm, it will expand. Its physical dimensions will expand. And if you connect the diaphragm to the strain gauge will estimates, measures its changes because of strain developed by the diaphragm on strain gauge. So we can measure force depending on the stress or strain using strain gauge. So students, go through the data in this slide. In next class, we will see what is actuator.